Okay, I'm Andre Mamolia, president of the Law and History Society, and the reason I'm drenched in sweat is because the delivery man didn't bring plates, and I was just so lucky to have 165 plates in my car. This is the first in a series of lectures organized by the Law and History Society on law and history. Some of the other lectures will be on topics such as legal order in the antebellum South, international law and the early republic, the Whig conception of the presidency, the use of evidence in medieval witch trials. I know a lot of you are going to go through that, you know. How do we know she's a witch? Because she looks like one. And an interesting lecture to finish everything off on Hirabayashi and the government's use of evidence in that case. Apparently, they misused it badly. Hirabayashi, for those of you who are not familiar with the case, was the one involving curfews for Japanese Americans during the Second World War. All of our lectures are webcast, but we're glad that you guys are here to actually interact with the speaker, and we will have a lengthy question-and-answer discussion in this lecture. And we're also we would also like to thank the Federalist Society and the American Constitutional Society for publicizing this event. We're really grateful for that. This lecture will focus on a topic that has been relatively neglected, which is the freedom of assembly. Professor Inazu, who is a visiting professor at Duke and a Duke alum, we'll talk about a subject that, that he's going to publish on in a forthcoming book, I think from Yale University Press, on the freedom of assembly. And I won't spoil the argument for you, but I think he's arguing for a return to the freedom of assembly. So please help me in welcoming Professor Inazu. Thanks.
Well, thanks to Andre and for the members of the Society for inviting me to speak here. It's a real privilege to be here, and I'm thrilled that there was both free lunch and very few competing events this afternoon. So it's great to see you here. I want to talk a little bit about how I got into this project. My book is going to be called The Forgotten Freedom of Assembly, and I started this when I was a law clerk working on a First Amendment issue. And can you all hear me through this? Okay, and I was looking at the text of the First Amendment, researching this case, and I looked down and I saw the right of the people peaceably to assemble, and I thought, that's very odd. I hadn't thought of this in law school. I don't remember any cases about it. I certainly hadn't seen it in practice. I practiced for 4 years before clerking, and so I thought, well, what's happened with this right of assembly? And so I did some preliminary research and looked in the literature, the legal scholarship. I found one article in the last 40 years on the right of assembly, which is odd since it's in the text of the Constitution. There was also one book by a communications professor, and that's it. And so then I turned to the case law and thought, well, certainly there's been case law on the freedom of assembly. It turns out the Supreme Court has mentioned the right of assembly 6 times in 20 years, two of those coming in the recent Second Amendment cases, Heller and McDonald. So when I got started on this a few years ago, 4 times in 20 years had the court mentioned assembly, and the last time it actually took a case involving the right of assembly was about 30 years ago. So there's this whole lack of really any modern sense or awareness of assembly. And so you might think, well, there could be an explanation for that, John. It could be that it's just not important and no one really cares. And certainly people have made that argument against me. I think otherwise, and for those of you who are not just history buffs, I'm going to try to tell you why I think you should care. And it has to do with the idea that we might conceive of the right of assembly as tied to the right to exist as groups. And that might strike you as more broad than the intuitive text suggests, but I'll try to explain why that's the case. But if groups are important, then this right is important. Why would groups be important? Well, there's lots of what we learn from political theory about that, certainly as a check against the authority of a centralized government, right? You want to be able to form groups to resist the state. This is sort of the anti-totalitarian arguments. But also, groups allow us to exist in this is a Tocquevillian sort of sense, but we form a robust pluralism. We like to be in groups and to do our own thing against sometimes the norms of what everyone else tells us to do. And when we do this in groups, the meaning and the message and the expression of what we do is often internal to a group's norms. Now that, let me unpack that a little bit because that started to sound a little academic. Think about this from your own perspectives. You know this if you've been in a fraternity, a sorority, a religious group, the Boy Scouts, a sports team. When you have a ritual or a practice or something internal to your group, it might not have very much meaning to others, right? It might look stupid. It might even look offensive to others. But in your group, this matters. And the only way to protect these kinds of practices is if we get serious about protecting groups. And then finally, groups play into the way that we form our identities. We don't just exist out there as autonomous selves, but we are shaped by the people around us. And again, this is also intuitive if you think about it. Who are the influences on your lives? If the state gets to say what your groups are, how they exist, and who gets to be a part of them, then the state is in some ways controlling how you think of your own identity. And these are issues that are raised in a lot of current debates. But if you buy that, if you're nodding your heads to some extent to these, then I want to suggest two things to you. First of all, the current doctrine of the right of association does not value these goods and does not protect these values adequately. And I won't say much about that today, but for those of you who are interested in another lunch and more discussion on Thursday when we discuss the Christian Legal Society case, these kinds of issues will come up. And I'll be part of a panel with Professor Charles and one of the counsel from the Christian Legal Society in the recent Supreme Court case. But the second argument and the focus of what I'm going to do today is that the freedom of assembly actually offers us a better constitutional alternative to thinking about groups. Now, I'm rooting this, and part of the reason why this makes sense to be part of a law and history talk is I'm rooting it in a constitutional tradition. This is not just sort of John's pie-in-the-sky theory of the good society, right? But this is something, an argument that I'm making from the history of our country, from various texts, from various cases. And that's what I'm going to get into today. And I have a couple of questions that I just want you to think about, and maybe, you know, feel free to press me on them during the Q&A as we get into this. But as a non-historian, I'm a political theorist by training, as a non-historian, I am fascinated and vexed by the questions of history and trying to do history in the furtherance of an argument. So some of the things that come to mind are, what is the role of history in thinking through an argument from constitutional tradition? What is the role of case law and language from case law in making supporting arguments, right? And there are easy ways to distort that, to misuse it, to turn it into rhetoric. And then finally, what do you do with multiple histories and multiple traditions, which, you know, as I see it, is very much in play in this particular debate, that you could trace history in lots of different ways. So how do you reconcile some of the tensions there? And that's what I hope to explore, and I'll try to go quickly through the historical points, and then hopefully you all have some questions to press me or ask me about on that. But let's start with, and I have a handout. Did everyone get that or can see a copy of it? I have a handout of some key texts in the front as the First Amendment itself, which is a good place to start, to borrow a line from Professor Ernie Young. If it's in the Constitution, that has to mean something, right? And so why don't we start there? So we look, if you look at the top of that page, Congress shall make no law respecting a lot of important things, and then the right of the people peaceably to assemble, comma, and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. Now, one of the first arguments out of the gates to me, John, you're arguing for this robust right of assembly, but maybe it's just not that big because it's limited by the text of the Constitution. And one way to look at that is if you look at the word right, it's singular. Right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition. And so a number of scholars and courts have said that the right of assembly is only for the purpose of petition. So in other words, you have this right, you can get together with a group of your friends, you can physically sign a document and present it to your government, and that's it. And if that's right, then I don't have much to work on, do I? Because that's just not going to get us very far in terms of my theory and vision of groups and pluralism. But I think it's wrong, and I'm going to make a couple of suggestions as to why. It starts with that comma that I pointed out. And for those of you who are currently embedded in, you know, classes of statutory interpretation and this sort of thing, we don't want to apply that kind of analysis to the actual text of the Constitution. This sort of thinking and high-level dissection of phrases and punctuation just was not in play at the founding and the framing. So I'm not trying to make a very careful textualist argument, but I do think that we have some hints from the punctuation. And where that goes, I've included in this handout below a couple earlier versions of what became the Assembly Clause. And the first one, which sort of highlights the point, is Madison's proposal to the House of Representatives. The people shall not be restrained from peaceably assembling and consulting for their common good, semicolon, nor from applying to the legislature by petitions and so forth. Now this suggests that at least at the onset when Madison first proposed it, that there are two separate rights going on here. An assembly is actually modified by the phrase or clause for their common good. And if you look back at the history, this in turn relies on several state proposals that are coming to the first Congress at the time. And I'm not going to read the rest of these iterations, but essentially what happens is this phrase, for their common good, succeeds in the House versions and in the early Senate versions, and then just drops out. And it's a sort of a strangely absent historical record. There's no reason why it drops out, given there's no record of that particular debate, but it just leaves. But what's left is the comma. So if you're looking, you know, you might think to yourself, well, they just threw in commas everywhere and we can't really tell much from it. But in this case, I think you actually can see this comma as originally tied to the clause for their common good, which if you look at the text in context, signals more strongly than the present text that we actually had two rights at the beginning, a right of assembly and a right of petition. So that's one indication from the framing as to why this might be a broader right. The second is that during the House debates, someone asked, well, aren't we just wasting our time with the right of assembly? We already have a right to speech. That does all the work, and we shouldn't be bothered by just sort of thinking through and voting on these other rights. And the response to that phrase was essentially an extended and powerful reference to the trial of William Penn, the 1670 trial in which the religious leader William Penn was arrested for violating the right of assembly and then tried and convicted. And the historians who study this era say that it's almost certain that most of the people in the House automatically got that reference. They understood Penn and Penn's importance. Penn was arrested and tried for an act of religious worship. It had nothing to do with petitioning the government. And when the vote on whether to continue with the Assembly Clause occurred, it happened right after this comment. So there's some evidence here that, you know, on the minds of the members of the House is that we're talking about a right that extends beyond petition. And that also makes sense historically when we think about the purpose of the First Amendment, right? Assembly is pretty close to free exercise. And when you think about the antecedents to the founding, when you think of colonialists like Roger Williams and William Penn, who argued for very strong religious protections and religious diversity and founded four of the 13 colonies, right? There's a very long and strong historical record about this kind of dissent. And that's where I'm sort of rooting the broader argument for assembly. But then I run into a second historical hurdle, and that is, I'll step back to some of the social movements a little later on, but there's another textual problem, and that occurs at the end of the 19th century. There's a case called United States against Cruikshank, which until recently was sort of relegated to obscurity. Two recent events have made that a little more well-known. One is Charles Lane, who was a Washington Post reporter, wrote a fascinating book called The Day Freedom Died. I mean, as lawyers in training, this is a wonderful and easy read, but it, you know, just sort of about the total absence of the rule of law in the Reconstruction South and why that matters to people thinking about the good of the country and the good of politics. But Lane highlights this case, and then as I mentioned, in Heller and McDonald, the court in doing its Second Amendment interpretation looks back at this case as well. I was probably the only person in the country to read those decisions and think, they're talking about the right of assembly, right? Everyone else was worried about the Second Amendment, but I was actually very thrilled about the first in those cases. Cruikshank is actually a very complex case. There's a lot going on. It's sort of an anti-incorporation case, and there are a lot of different arguments and textual moves going on with the court, but I've included some of the key language on the back of this handout. And just quickly, the opening sentences or the opening lines of those two paragraphs. First, the court says, the right of the people peaceably to assemble for lawful purposes, and then it goes on a few paragraphs later and says, the right of the people peaceably to assemble for the purpose of petitioning Congress for redress of grievances. So if you think back to the earlier discussion about whether we're talking about one right or two, here's a possible suggestion from the court that we're talking about one right. Now, actually, if you read on, in Cruikshank, comma, or for anything else connected with the powers of the national government, the court isn't really saying this, and in the preceding paragraph that I've included there, in fact, we're talking about assembly for lawful purposes. But 10 years later, another Supreme Court decision looks back at Cruikshank, this is Presser against Illinois, and says the right peaceably to assemble was not protected unless the purpose of assembly was to petition the government, right? That's pretty indisputable about what that is saying. I think the court just was sloppy there and was wrong. A number of scholars have picked up on the language, in Presser especially, and said, Assembly is limited to the purpose of petition. But that's not really how anyone else has interpreted that decision or the assembly clause. And in fact, as the quotes I have from Heller and McDonald more recently just sort of assume that we're talking about two different rights and that the right of assembly stands on its own. So that's sort of a lot of work, but hopefully to some extent historical work against the textual argument that might limit assembly. But I also think when we think about doing history or making constitutional arguments, that we step certainly outside of the text and look at other indicia of what might be included. And so the right of assembly in social movements, in public discourse, in the papers, in political rhetoric until these last 30 years has actually been pretty strong. And we just haven't yet done the history to draw that out. One important example was just after the right is incorporated in 1937, there is a flurry of assembly cases that few people really talk about too much. The one exception is the Hague decision, which created the public forum doctrine, right? If you've taken First Amendment, you know this case. But there are three or four important cases right at the end of the 30s that highlight the right of assembly. And around this time in the New York's World Fair, the organizers of the fair decided, why not highlight the importance of the Bill of Rights and specifically the rights of speech, press, religion, and assembly. And so there are monuments constructed in New York. There's a monument to the freedom of assembly. And there are weekly op-eds in the New York Times about the role of assembly against the growing threat, right, in Europe. And it's sort of this flowing up into popular discourse about the importance of assembly. There are, on the opening day of the fair, the broadcast from Radio City Music Hall internationally is a tribute to the freedom of assembly penned by Dorothy Thompson, who at the time was a very prominent female journalist. And then even Roosevelt himself adopts this language of assembly and endorses what he calls the four freedoms. Now, from social studies class, if you'll remember from high school, you can check off the four freedoms, and assembly isn't there, right? Freedom of expression, freedom of religion, freedom from want, freedom from fear. But there were actually four freedoms phrased that way that preceded Roosevelt's four, and assembly was one of them. And Roosevelt, in tributes to the Bill of Rights in early 41, is seen in photographs heralding these four rights, including assembly. And apparently, we're not sure why, but his speechwriters like the second formulation better, and that's the one that took off, right? So assembly sort of lost out there for a second time. There's a fascinating picture, which I hope will be the cover of my book, which is Roosevelt signing a proclamation for Bill of Rights Day in early, I think it's late November 1941. And there's this huge placard right behind him that says, freedom of speech, freedom of press, religion, assembly. Right, and then it's just about a month later that he signs the executive order that sends the Japanese Americans to the internment camps, clearly denying them assembly among other freedoms. And I'll be very interested in that talk as well. Later on, my grandparents were among those interned, so I have a personal sense of the deprivations of those particular freedoms. There are some other historical sources of evidence, and one of them, which I hadn't stumbled upon until recently, is the presence of assembly in state constitutional decisions and case law. So absent incorporation and absent a lot of federal case law, the states are really handling this. So let me read to you just quickly a couple of state court passages on the right of assembly. This is from an 1832 decision by the Supreme Court of Massachusetts. To form an original society, several persons must agree to unite. The society then exists to some purposes and may be called together and organized. Under a warrant of a justice of the peace, calling a meeting of such society, all those persons who have thus agreed and associated would have a right to assemble and act and no others. Right? Some very relevant language to some of the cases we've seen in our day, just last term, in fact. And then another case, this from Illinois. It would be a startling proposition that under the general grant of power authorizing cities and villages to declare what shall be nuisances, that they could prevent the people from assembling in a peaceable and orderly manner on suitable occasions to indulge in healthful recreations and innocent amusements. This is not assembly to petition. It is difficult to perceive why dancing in the open air is per se any more reprehensible or more of a nuisance than playing at leapfrog or lawn tennis. The groves and green woods are nature's own temples to which the people have the right to repair. for rational sports and social intercourse, provided they do not disturb the public peace. The framers of the Constitution inserted in that instrument a clause making inviolate the right of the people to assemble in a peaceful manner to consult for the common good. And it may be supposed that they would have added the right to assemble for open air amusements had anyone imagined that the power to deny the exercise of such right would ever be asserted. Right? So again, sort of from state law decisions and also constitutional treatises at the time, there are a number of these that pick up in these decisions and emphasize the broader import of assembly. And then finally, I mentioned social movements. And here, the fun work for me researching this was to go outside of the discipline of law per se and look to historical treatments of some of the social movements. And there's very rich descriptive language about what is going on in not only the kinds of movements we might think of today, but also the abolitionist movement, the suffrage movement, the early gay rights movement, all kinds of examples where groups trying to form, and not just purely political groups, but groups trying to form have asserted the right of assemble or the right of assembly, or have evidenced their need and desire to have more of an interaction, more of a groupness than simply a political kind of meeting. This was very clear as I looked into the history on antebellum restrictions against free and slave African Americans. All through the South, there are statute after statute that are restricting the assembly of African Americans, and it's against assembly for purposes of feasting, assembly to educate, assembly for religious worship, right? People aren't caring about political assembly, large P, but assembly for all these other purposes. Here's one example of a petition from Mississippi. White citizens distraught over crowds of Negroes drinking, fiddling, dancing, singing, cursing, whooping, and yelling, to the great annoyance and scandal of all respectable and order-loving persons, sought to restrict the assembly of Negroes. And then from the flip side of that, we have a slave narrative from a Methodist minister, James Smith, who describes restrictions on assembly. And these restrictions intensified greatly after Nat Turner's rebellion, when there was a large concern that the religious or the purportedly religious influences behind that rebellion were spreading throughout slave and free African Americans. So this is how Smith describes the transformation. And he starts by talking about prior to Turner's rebellion. The way in which we worshiped is almost indescribable. The singing was accompanied by a certain ecstasy of motion, clapping of hands, tossing of heads, which would continue without cessation about half an hour. One would lead off in a kind of recitative style, others joining in the chorus. The old house partook of the ecstasy. It rang with their jubilant shouts and shook in all its joints. When Nat Turner's insurrection broke out, the colored people were forbidden to hold meetings among themselves. Right, so the restrictions against slave and free African Americans were going very much to the core of their social existence, their ability to unite and to live life in all of these different ways. And there are similar examples and quotes that we could pull from the women's movement. The wonderful book that was written on the right of assembly dealt largely with the women's movement and highlights the importance of potato sack races and beauty pageants and these kinds of gathering to facilitating the early women's movement. And then in the 60s and 70s, the early gay rights movement, very much dependent upon social clubs and these kinds of organizations. And the courts, in fact, upheld those associational restrictions against what were often, right, much stronger laws at the time in the 60s and 70s. I want to just sort of close the historical piece or the social movement piece with a quote from John Hope Franklin, who's describing another form of this kind of gathering with the Harlem Renaissance that occurred sort of in the progressive era around the time of Marcus Garvey in Harlem, obviously. And he writes, "It was only natural that leaders of the Harlem Renaissance would tend to move in the same social circles. There was a community of spirit and point of view that found its expression not only in the cooperative ventures of a professional nature, but also in the intimate social relationships that developed. Perhaps these Harlemites felt that form and substance could be given to their efforts through the interchange of ideas in moments of informality." And I love the way he phrases that, moments of informality. That's what I'm trying to talk about when thinking about extending the protections to groups beyond just merely political groups. So briefly then, what has happened to the right of assembly? Why do I think that it's not around today? Other than some of the textual arguments that I highlighted, I think there are two main doctrinal and constitutional developments. And one is that the free speech doctrine that emerged in the last 20 or 30 years has really crowded out assembly. So when you look at a case like Perry that established or entrenched the public forum doctrine, Perry looks to Hague, the 1939 case, treats it only as a free speech case, and then cites a bunch of free speech cases in support of the public forum doctrine. And then later cases that rely on Perry treat it only as a public forum sort of analysis. And so as an example, in 1988, when the court looks at Booz against Berry, this is a case in which a District of Columbia regulation prohibited protesters within 500 feet of certain foreign office buildings. Right? The classic case of, you know, even assembly in the narrow sense, right? Holding your picket sign outside of a building. And it's totally a free speech analysis. It was briefed to the court as an assembly case, and the court looked to Perry and decided it under free speech. So where does assembly go if it's not holding up a placard? There's not much more room for it. But the other development that I think is more dangerous is the development of the right of association. And this is sort of a good warning to those of you who clerk. If you cite the Constitution, be sure to look at the text before you turn in your draft. So there are actually over 25 federal court decisions that cite a freedom of association clause in the First Amendment, and it does not exist, right? So be careful in your citations. But that's an example of sort of how the extent to which the right of association is just embedded in our minds. I would guess that many of you, before hearing me go on and on about the right of assembly, probably hadn't thought about it, but you have heard of the right of association, and particularly the right of expressive association that's at issue in a number of these more recent cases. I think that does damage to the kind of constitutional vision that I'm arguing has existed for much of our country's history. And then a final point to add to that is that it's also bizarre when you consider our broader First Amendment jurisprudence, right? So in the speech context, we go out of our way to protect Larry Flint and Nazis and people who want to make videos about torturing small animals, right? And all of these sorts of reprehensible people and practices and activities. But when it comes to groups, we think very differently about them, and we inhibit and we quell expression and group formation in very different ways. And I think that that's a problem that we need to deal with constitutionally, and I think that the right of assembly offers some resources to start addressing that problem. So thank you very much for your time, and I look forward to your questions.
Any questions? Okay, I'll take the first stab. And as the president of the Law and History Society, it's only fair that I take the historical stand. So at the very beginning, in the early Republic, when we had all these different groups working, a lot of different ethnic groups, religious groups, state identities, we moved away from that. And some people would argue that that's a good thing, that the plurality that existed in the early Republic was a necessity, not a virtue. It's because people didn't get along and they had to sort of tolerate each other. They didn't want anybody to take control. And the fact that we've moved on to an American ethos, an ethos that encompasses everybody, is generally a good thing. And that the reason the Supreme Court has been more willing to talk about normative matters within the past decades or so is because it can speak towards an audience that is coherent, right? It can speak about the American Constitution, meaning not just the document, but also what the ethos of America is, not just about one group, but what about others. So I think in general, like saying that freedom of assembly and association is good is correct, but I'm more interested about when it hits with other values, competing values that are founded in this American ethos. And I think this is sort of segueing into what we're going to see you talk about on Thursday, but what do we do about when basic national values, like the value for, we'll take Stevens, for example. Like certain societies would say that it's against their basic norms for decency, to have pictures of animal torture because that does violence. And in some cases, you might want to draw a line between tolerating some groups and making room for others when these norms compete. So I'm asking you, defend the historical position.
Right. Well, so a couple points on that. First of all, I want to start by saying that we have to have some kind of consensus, right? We can't go forward without it. I'm not advocating for anarchy, and I'm not advocating for Babel. So we have to be able to talk to each other in some sense. But what concerns me historically is that we've often overreached in to the extent of how far that consensus has to go. And so one of actually my other chapters in the book explores in the mid-20th century, there's a powerful school of political thought that emerges primarily around Robert Dahl and other political theorists out of Yale. But these folks are saying that exactly this. We have a national consensus. We have national values. Madison was for these values. Tocqueville was for these values. I think, by the way, they get both Madison and Tocqueville wrong, and other people agree with me on that. But they're arguing very powerfully for this consensus. And what does this consensus exclude? Well, it turns out it excludes the Vietnam War protesters. It excludes much of the civil rights movement. It excludes a lot of people outside the margins of the accepted and the political discourse. And the critics of this mid-20th century pluralism point this out, and I think have convincingly won the argument. Now, today we see this consensus stretched in a very different direction, right? So we say we have these national values, and they extend the idea of equality, for example, very far. And so groups at the margins, and in the case of the Christian Legal Society, right, in the case of the JCs that wanted to keep their membership to men only in 1984, these groups are outside of the consensus. But there are powerful, and you use the word normative, I think, correctly, right? There are powerful normative forces here. And the question is, do we really want to risk it when we're not talking about the health and stability of our nation? We do want to risk it, I think, in 1964, right, when we're trying to end segregation and when white segregationist groups raise some of these very arguments about strong associational principles. And at the end of the day, we say too bad to those arguments in a lot of different contexts. But outside of something like that, I'm not sure that we want to jump too quickly to entrench that consensus. Yeah.
From what I understand, one of your main concerns with the loss of this the right of assembly is that you feel that by ignoring it, the state gains more and more control over how their ability to influence how people think. Why is that such a big problem, considering the fact that they already have so many other tools in order to influence us, like it's public education, various welfare programs. So I mean.
Yeah, when you, in some ways, what you just expressed is sort of a further argument for my position, right? Which is the state is already encroaching quite a bit, so let's have the last bastion of protection be that we actually get to have private groups. There are a lot of theorists who want to dispel this line of public and private, and I think there are some very important arguments for doing that. But at the end of the day, I want to have a sense of the private. I want to have a family and my own groups that I can sort of exist in without the state telling me what to do there. So that's I think one answer to that question. Yeah.
In the beginning, you talked about the reason why groups are important, including kind of influencing your identity. And I know in some of the freedom of association cases, that's one of the reasons why we have intimate association. So why not try to push for a broader view of intimate and expressive association rather than kind of trying to go for this right of assembly, which, I mean, you know, hasn't been used very much throughout history.
Right, and to maybe build that question even more, why, when most legal academics are talking about intimate expressive association, why would you introduce this foreign concept over here, right? You might have a better shot of winning your argument if you're within their discourse. I think there's a lot of power to that question. I've encountered it quite often. One of the answers is I'm really trying to disrupt the current discourse. It would take far too long, but I could explain why, in my view, the rights of intimate association and expressive association are, one, completely made up, two, do some powerful constitutional work that's not justified, and three, leave us without meaningful distinctions. So on intimate association in particular, this sort of derives most directly from a law review article by Professor Ken Karst, it's a wonderful article talking about the value of groups, but then he says, and these are why intimate groups are even more important. And every reason he lists for protecting intimate groups are equally applicable to non-intimate groups, right? And so when you think about questions of identity formation and so forth, whether a group is three people or 10 people, your identity can be formed by them, right? And we're drawing these lines that are constitutionally significant but without much value. And so part of what I mean, my take on the Christian Legal Society case is we are here with a result that, I don't like because of these categories of association that, jettison a group like the Christian Legal Society to a lower level of constitutional protection. But I mean, it's a great question, and certainly the, one of the first ones that I often get when I'm talking with faculty.
Yep. It seems that one of the most interesting issues here is the potential for conflict between like individual rights and group rights. And what ideas or principles from political theory do you think can help us to address these kinds of issues?
Yeah, so that's a great question. The arguments from political theory that are going to most strongly support group rights are the arguments out of the communitarian literature, so Alistair MacIntyre, Michael Sandel, Charles Taylor. I'm very influenced by that kind of thinking, and also arguments from radical democracy, Sheldon Wolin, Rahm Koolhaas, and others like that, who are arguing about the importance of these groups. There is, in political theory, and I buy this too, there's an important argument for the rights of the individual. So what do you do in an illiberal group that oppresses women internally or children, right? What are the rights of those individuals? And the usual lines of argument, which I think are very important to consider seriously, are guaranteeing meaningful exit rights. So if a person in a group is in a particularly an illiberal group wants to get out, the state provides a mechanism for that person to leave. Now that's a very simple and easy answer to a complex question, because what does that mean, right? And what happens to questions of volition and these sorts of things, but that's where I think the debate has to happen. And at the end of the day, I am siding more strongly with the rights of the group to define its identity than the rights of the individual. I think one of the best counterarguments to my position is a very strong individualist argument that says, wait a minute, people on the individual level should have the right to break out of and transform groups. Yep.
So, you know, you kind of mentioned that it's difficult to kind of get into a hypertextual reading of the First Amendment. And with all due respect, you know, even some of the Supreme Court language you put on the back seems to me to be mixed. That's how the Supreme Court has really looked at it. So I wonder if there isn't maybe more, if you wouldn't have an easier time looking at kind of drawing a parallel between freedom of speech jurisprudence and looking at the right as a whole, and then looking at the degree to which we can read petitioning the government for grievances. Because obviously, so a group can march down, you know, Main Street, for a political reason, and they don't have to all sign a piece of paper and tack it to the door of City Hall in order to make that constitutionally sanctioned. So it seems to me that in practice, we allow groups like this to exist more because of a broader reasoning behind what petitioning the government for redress of grievances means, rather than kind of this assumed inherent right of just assembly in and of itself.
So let me respond quickly to the opening point, which is maybe there's some ambiguous language here, but the first, before we were to get into that discussion, we would both need to read the cases very carefully in full, right? And so I have excerpts here, and I agree that there is some language that you could point to, but as I've sort of studied the cases as a whole and other related cases, I think that I have the better argument here. But you know, you're right, then it's fair to push back and say, am I still getting into this hypertextualism, possibly? I think that starting with how we currently understand assembly is problematic for two reasons. One is sort of almost a rhetorical reason, but if I were to start with how the court currently understands assembly, my first example would be from the 1980s, right? And that's not a very... If that's the first point I have, then I'm already starting a bit behind. But the second one would be that I'm really pushing here for assembly as pointing toward a right not only to express in the moment, but to exist and to form before the moment. So the Christian Legal Society at Hastings Law School cannot march down the streets because it cannot exist under, right, the decision from last term. And so to push back to... Now, there are questions here about can it exist privately? It could exist privately, but it's not the Christian Legal Society at Hastings Law School anymore. And so what the court says by denying the group to have access to these resources or to have a place in the public forum, it's denying its existence. And I saw a couple heads nod or scratches there. This is not just a novel argument that I'm making. There are other right, courts and other positions that argue this too. But it's a contested claim, right? The comeback is, well, you're talking about the public forum, you're talking about the denial of a couple funds and official recognition, and we'll get into that hopefully a little more on Thursday if you're interested. But that was a very long answer to your more precise question. Yeah.
Do you have a sense of how the practice of assembly has changed over this time period from the 18th century to
That's a wonderful question of how to do history and how to interpret history, because when we look at historical moments and descriptions of history, the practice of assembly in different periods is very different, right? So Marcus Garvey, who I mentioned in the Progressive Era, his form of assembly is very flamboyant, right? I mean, he's wearing Napoleon-esque general's costumes and marching down the streets of New York City and has parades and bands. The Democratic Republican societies at the end of the 18th century, very similar sort of grandiose and flourishing displays at times. And then sometimes it's quieter and simpler. So I think it's just varied, right? And then today, this practice might be, in some cases, both more and less robust or expressive than in past times. Does that respond, or did you have a different thought in mind?
Of, you know, that modern assemblies or groups are coming out of a world where there's a lot more possibility of bringing people together than there was at that time. I mean, so I was thinking more along those lines rather than how colorful they are.
Well, one really interesting question to me is how does this concept apply to online groups? Can we extend the right of assembly to an online context? And I started writing another chapter on this, and it just got too carried away in terms of cyber law and these sorts of arguments. But it's a fascinating question to consider whether eHarmony, for example, could constitute an assembly, right? eHarmony is currently facing anti-discrimination lawsuits. And so could eHarmony have access to this sort of claim? Or what about Facebook? Is Facebook an assembly of your friends, right? And if so, is Facebook an intimate association or an expressive association? What if I have 5 friends and you have 5,000, but you know your 5,000 better? Who's more intimate, right? These are some of the questions that the online context emerges. I think there's a whole lot of fascinating debate there, and I just, when I started to get into it, I realized I needed to save that for another project.
Yeah. Following up on his question, I'm wondering if you have comment on Robert Putnam's theory and that bowling alone and that we're assembling less, and if that matters at all to forthcoming growth.
Putnam's work is great. So this book, if you haven't read it or heard of it, Bowling Alone, a very famous book from the 80s or early 90s, I think, and it's tied somewhat to the communitarian literature, although a little more empirical, I think. And Putnam's argument is basically, look, we're no longer joining these groups. We don't have a robust sense of collective identity in these groups. We're just, as he says, bowling alone. I think there's a lot to the critique, and I think it's even can be lobbied more strongly against the online generation that thinks it's connected in groups but really isn't, right? So, I mean, how real are our Facebook friends, for example? Those are very serious questions to issues of social capital, as Putnam says. But I think I think Putnam's on to something, and that's the kind of vision that I'm trying to grasp and say that we need to think about. Yeah.
It was assumed temporarily that the clause from the original versions of the First Amendment, the consulting for their common good, had been retained in the final version. To what extent do you think that would, I guess, solidify or consolidate the position that you're advocating for a more general formulation of the freedom of assembly?
I think it depends on which version of common good was accepted. And so if you look at actually current state constitutional provisions, many of the states retain that language, and they vary. And there was a fierce debate that I didn't mention as to whether the phrase should be assembly for the common good, definite article, or assembly for their common good, possessive pronoun, right? And there's a difference there if you think about it. Their common good, the people assembling for their common good, if you understand people in a certain way, could be an anti-consensus move, right? Whereas the common good, in a little our Republican sense, might be the good of the nation, for example. So if we have assembly for the common good, then I think it cuts against my argument. If we have assembly for their common good, it might support my argument. So, well, I'll stop there. Thanks so much for your time. And